If you take a look around you, how many items of plastic can you see? So many things in this room are made of plastic. I mean, even the camera we're recording this on. And so are these headphones. Do you think living in a world without plastic can ever be a realistic goal? Plastic revolutionized modern life, changing our lifestyles and shopping habits forever. Through globalization, innovation, and mass manufacturing, the world has become a lot fuller. We have a whole lot of stuff, and a whole lot of it is made of plastic. But scientists have been warning us for decades about our unsustainable habits and the repercussions of our plastic dependency. Today, plastic waste has become one of the most pressing environmental problems. It pollutes our waters, soil, air, and bodies. And that's just the tip of a very big plastic iceberg. Of course, efforts to reduce plastic use or substitute it with existing materials are great, but it isn't possible to stop producing plastic completely because many important industries rely on it. Single-use plastics have been crucial to improvements made in modern medicine and helps protect food products from deteriorating. But that makes me wonder, if we can't simply stop producing plastic, is there anything new that could replace it? Once upon a time, plastic didn't exist, but that world now seems like a fairy tale. So how did it all really begin? Well, the year is 1863, and a $10,000 reward is offered to the inventor who finds a solution to a rather expensive problem, ivory. Before plastic, ivory was an expensive material used to produce everything from combs and piano keys to jewelry and billiard balls. But it was growing scarce as hunting reduced elephant populations. Enter John Wesley Hyatt, engineer and inventor from New York. Hyatt attempted to create a viable replacement for ivory billiard balls, experimenting with cellulose, a molecule found in the cell walls of plant cells. And in 1869, he invented celluloid, a moldable plastic, meaning it could be shaped when hot. It was also inexpensive and easy to produce. Unfortunately, celluloid turned out to be highly flammable and not an ideal material for everyday use. But it did provide the foundation for a century of plastic innovation. And though people no longer needed to hunt elephants for their ivory, you could say that by attempting to solve one ecological problem, we created an even bigger environmental one. Today, the most common plastics are made from fossil fuels, crude oil, natural gas, and coal. These fossil or fossil fuel-based plastics are much more cost-effective, easy to manufacture, and very moldable, meaning they can be used to make a whole range of products. This economical ease of production, when combined with their durable, hygienic, and versatile properties, have made fossil-based plastics extremely pervasive. Take fashion, for example. You might not know that polyester, nylon, and acrylic are fossil-based fabrics and are found in around 64% of new clothes. The problem is, every time they get washed, they release tiny microplastics. In fact, around 500,000 tons of these microplastics make their way from our washing machines into the oceans every year before making their way into our food chain. And that's the equivalent of 50 Eiffel Towers.
Although we don't necessarily know the cumulative impacts of microplastics on humans, we know that some of the chemicals that are used in plastic are called endocrine disruptors, and they can interfere with our hormonal processes.
So over the years, scientists have tried to develop new plastics that can biodegrade, meaning they will break down faster. This has resulted in the development of plastics produced from renewable biomass sources, like cornstarch or vegetable oil. Basically, anything natural that isn't a fossil fuel. These are commonly referred to as bioplastics. And while they might sound promising, that's not always the case. These bioplastics account for less than 1% of plastic overall. And in many cases, they still pollute our environment and don't actually break down any more quickly than fossil-based plastics. Now, you might be thinking, why can't we just recycle our plastic waste?
Recycling isn't necessarily the fix-all or the cure-all for our plastic problem. Only 9% of plastic is recycled globally. And in the US, actually, it went down to 5 to 6% in 2021. Many cities and local governments don't have the infrastructure to engage in effective plastic recycling. Oftentimes, if you have all of the plastics being gathered at once and they're not sorted, it can sort of contaminate the recycling stream, and then it just becomes useless and not a material that can be used in the future.
So what happens to the plastic that isn't recycled then? How long will it last in the environment?
Because plastic is a relatively new material, we don't really know for certain how long it will last in our environment. Some studies sort of estimate that a plastic bottle could last in our environment for upwards of 400 years.
So what viable alternatives do we have? Well, there are some really innovative plastic substitutes, but there's one that has really caught my eye: seaweed. Seaweed actually refers to thousands of species of marine algae and plants, which absorb carbon dioxide as they grow.
Seaweed is a really cool resource because it grows really quickly and it doesn't compete with land or water resources, which we sometimes see with other alternatives to plastic.
And do you remember celluloid? Well, seaweed also contains cellulose, making it an ideal candidate for the production of biodegradable plastic alternatives. Seaweed can be converted into a hard and moldable substance that has the potential to function in the same way as plastic made from fossil fuels. In fact, the substance can be just as durable and versatile. Astonishingly, some seaweeds have film-forming properties and can be made into functional single-use bioplastics, which can break down in soil, some in just 4 to 6 weeks. However, fossil-based plastic status as hard-wearing and cost-effective is what makes it so tough to replace. But seaweed-based plastic is definitely tough competition, and we've got good reason to be optimistic. Products utilizing seaweed as a replacement for fossil-based plastic have been popping up more and more from companies like Notpla, who teamed up with the organizers of the 2019 London Marathon to replace plastic water bottles with seaweed-based alternatives. From coffee cups to food packaging, it's an incredibly effective replacement, but it's even more versatile than that. Some seaweed-based plastics can be processed into fabric in the same way as fossil-based plastic, and you really wouldn't notice a difference once they're in your sneakers. So what's stopping us from just replacing all plastics with seaweed-based alternatives? Well, we need to consider the needs of existing industries that rely on fossil-based plastic, like the medical industry.
That keeps things, you know, fresh and safe and sterile. And we saw during the pandemic how valuable plastic was in terms of keeping communities safe.
I also can't help but wonder, if seaweed-based plastic is mass-produced, would its production be able to retain its eco-friendly status? Or would other unforeseen issues occur, just as it did with plastic, a material once hailed as a solution to the ivory problem? Luckily, scientists are working on a multitude of fossil-based plastic replacements. But that isn't all we can do.
Considering the alternatives along with sort of thinking more circularly and reducing and eliminating the plastic that we don't need in our lives is really the best way to achieve like an optimum outcome.
Maybe someday we'll all be wearing shoes made from mushrooms and carrying our groceries in bags made from shrimp shells alongside our algae-based coffee cups. We just aren't there yet. Let us know in the comments what you think could be the future of plastic. Thank you for joining us on this episode of Scope. Make sure to like and subscribe so you don't miss the next episode. See you next time.